Now we're continuing our series this morning, and can I get you to open in your Bible to Luke chapter 1, first of all, verse 26. Some familiar words in the church Bibles, it's page 1025. Luke 1, we're picking up in verse 26. We're going to read a little section there and then go into chapter 2. In the sixth month of Elizabeth's pregnancy, God sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth, a town in Galilee, to a virgin pledged to be married to a man named Joseph, a descendant of David. The virgin's name was Mary. The angel went to her and said, "Greetings, you who are highly favoured. The Lord is with you." Mary was greatly troubled at his words and wondered what kind of greeting this might be. But the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary. You have found favour with God. You will conceive and give birth to a son, and you are to call him Jesus. He will be great and would be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over Jacob's descendants forever. His kingdom will never end." Now, if you turn the page to chapter 2, and we'll pick up in verse 1. In those days, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that a census should be taken of the entire Roman world. This was the first census that took place while Quirinius was governor of Syria. And everyone went to their own town to register. So Joseph also went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to Bethlehem, the town of David, because he belonged to the house and line of David. He went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for the baby to be born, and she gave birth to her firstborn, a son. She wrapped him in cloths and placed him in a manger because there was no guest room available for them. And there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all the people. Today in the town of David, a Saviour has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger." Well, do keep your Bible open there. It's just a brief passage we're looking at this morning, but let's pray before we do that. Our Heavenly Father, we pray that you would indeed fill our hearts with the quiet joy that comes from knowing the Saviour that you sent into our world. And we pray this in his name. Amen. Well, again, welcome to part two of our little Christmas mini-series that we've called, in a tongue-in-cheek way, The Big Words of Christmas. And not, as I said last week, the big theological words of Christmas that most people don't even understand, but the most significant and most enduring words, like hope, which we looked at last Sunday, and peace, which we'll be looking at Christmas Eve and Christmas morning, and this morning, joy, which I think wins the award as the most popular word on Christmas cards and in carols. Joy to the world. I'm wishing you Yuletide joy. We used to get that on sparkle-coloured Christmas-covered Christmas cards when I was a kid. I never actually knew what it meant. Mind you, I could never figure out who Noel was either and why he got so many cards. But back to joy. Today's big word, J-O-Y, joy. It's only three letters long, but at Christmas time, of course, you will see joy everywhere. You'll see joy being offered in shop windows, even if all they're really offering is Botox and microdermabrasion for your skin. Is that where joy to the world is going to come from? I guess it's going to depend how much you're worried by your wrinkles. You will see it at Chermside. All the cleaners are wearing T-shirts that say, "All we see is joy this Christmas." Do you think that's really true? I reckon what they're mainly seeing is a whole lot of our rubbish. And life can be like that, can't it? You can put on a brave face to the world, you can act joyful, when all around you life is just rubbish as far as you can see. Like hope, which we looked at last Sunday, the little word joy is a big word at Christmas because if it's missing, there is a huge gap, isn't there? So the question is, what is this thing called joy and where do you get it? At a most basic level, it is a feeling, I guess, joy when you define it, a feeling closely related to happiness, but somehow deeper. If you want to get happy, a recent article in Time magazine has some practical tips from a neuroscience researcher. Number one, listen to music from the happiest time in your life. Apparently it really works, especially if the happiest time in your life, I guess, was when Pharrell Williams was singing the song Happy. But I mean, apparently it really does work. Music has an incredible time machine ability to connect you with how you were feeling at another time, when you were first in love, or on that holiday in a faraway place. Number two, and this one sounds just as unlikely, but apparently it's scientifically true, that is, even if you don't feel like it, if you want to be happy, smile. Because it turns out that the body actually, in a sense, works backwards as well as forwards. There is a biofeedback loop, scientists say, where your brain senses what your body's doing as a cue to how it should be feeling. And so if you smile, there's part of your brain that says, oh, I must be feeling happy, and starts boosting your endorphins. And they say it's powerful. Apparently they have measured the effect, and it's the equivalent of the pleasure you would get from 2,000 bars of chocolate, just by smiling. Here's another one, the third one, if you want to be happy, apparently the most powerful of them all. Go for a morning walk outside with a friend. Now, it's got to be in the morning. It's got to be outside, not on a treadmill at the gym. And you've got to have a friend. But apparently, put those ingredients together, you will feel happier, at least while you're doing it and for a little while afterwards. Now look, those tips are good, and feel free to try them out. But here's the thing. Happiness like that depends on happenings, doesn't it? Even if it's just a small happening, like a morning walk. Happiness comes and happiness goes. Sure, it might help if you smile, but what happens when the smile slips a while? What our hearts really long for is something more profound. And every now and then we catch a glimpse of it, we catch a taste of joy, which, as the Bible describes it, comes from somewhere deeper. In the New Testament, it's interesting, the word we translate as joy is kind of the direct flip side of the word for generosity or grace. They are a matching word pair. So generosity in the original language is charis, and joy is chara, which, if you can imagine, a surprising and delightful gift, much like the one I'm sure you're giving your husband or your wife for Christmas, that is the enjoyment they will feel in response to your generosity. A feeling of celebration, in a sense, of being treated graciously. Now, it's interesting, the generosity word is there in Mary's encounter with the angel in Luke chapter 1, where she's given that astonishing news that she's expecting this most unexpected baby. And as you would expect at first, she's troubled and she's terrified. The angel says this to her. It's in verse 30 of chapter 1. Don't be afraid, Mary, you have found favour with God. Now, you peel back the English translation, you look at the original word there, it's you have found charis. You've found God's generosity. You're being treated wonderfully well in a way that's going to bring joy and not fear. Now, you see, that's remarkably similar then to the message the angel brings to the shepherds in Luke chapter 2, and the reason we so closely associate the idea of joy with the first Christmas. Inconveniently, it's right near the end of Mary's third trimester, and the government's called a census, which, because of the decree of Caesar Augustus, means that everyone's got to go to their ancestral hometown. Joseph is in the line of David, which means they have to head off all the way to Bethlehem, David's hometown, which, not by coincidence, is the town where the scriptures say the coming Messiah was to be born into the family line of David. You get those simple words in verse 6 and 7 of chapter 2. The time comes for the baby to be born, and she gives birth to her firstborn, a son. She wraps him in cloths and puts him in a manger, a feed box, because there's no guest room available for them. Now those words, they are brief, they are uncomplaining, but it's awful, isn't it? Every now and then, you know, you hear of a baby born by the side of the road in a car because they didn't quite make it to the hospital. So I've got a friend whose kid's middle name is Ampol, after the service station where he was born in the back seat. Now, this is like that. Humble circumstances, which I would imagine in most cases would leave you feeling disappointed and let down and even a bit grumpy. Nobody could find any room for them. But don't despair. Mary has been told that God is being gracious to her. A cow shed will do. In fact, in spite of the circumstances, from what happens next, you can see it is in fact time to celebrate in a way that the world's been doing ever since. There are shepherds in the fields just out of town. They're watching their sheep. And when he appears in a blinding light in verse 9, the angel has the same effect that he had on Mary. Luke tells us how the angel of the Lord appears to them and the glory of the Lord shines around them and they are terrified. But again, almost the same words as to Mary. Don't be afraid. I'm bringing you good news that will cause great joy for all the people. It's that mirror word I was talking about. Joy, kara. The feeling you get when you've been treated with charis, generosity. Because today in the town of David, says the angel, a saviour has been born to you. He's the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You'll find a baby wrapped in rags and lying in a feed trough. Good news. It's literally the word gospel there, an announcement of God's good pleasure. News that will cause not just a minor passing bubble of happiness, but a great joy of knowing that once and for all you have been treated with huge favour by the God of the universe, who is keeping his Old Testament promises to Israel, who is stepping into humanity in the person of his one and only Son, who is going to save and lead and rule a kingdom with no end. No wonder there is going to be joy. Just look at those two angel messages together again. Don't be afraid, Mary. Don't be afraid, shepherds. You have found charis, God's generosity. This is news that will cause great kara, great joy, the response. Joy is the natural flip side of God's generosity in Jesus. Not fear, but favour. Not fear, but joy. Which I think is pretty much how the biblical idea of joy is meant to work. Regardless of circumstances, regardless of conditions, regardless of the ups and downs of life. Now look, you know, that's only amplified by what happens in the rest of Luke's gospel. You know the story. This baby grows in wisdom and stature into a fully fledged Messiah. Powerful words, powerful deeds. It is obvious at every point that he is pushing back on the kingdom of darkness. And then it seems disaster, as the Jewish leaders themselves, instead of welcoming him to Jerusalem as king, drag him before the Roman rulers on a charge of treason, have him whipped and have him crucified. And joy, it seems, is extinguished. If you knew that was the way the new Star Wars movie was going to end, would you still go and see it? If you knew that the Jesus story just ended with the main character dead in a tomb, would there be any reason for joy? All the promise of the angel's words to Mary, all the promise of the angel's words to the shepherds, gone in a puff of smoke. Where is the good news in that? Where is the grace and favour? Well, look, it's interesting as Luke unfolds the story in his gospel because, of course, that's not the ending at all, is it? And there is huge reason for joy because the third day, the same Jesus who truly died is truly alive again. And when they see him, people are astonished. And just like when they saw the angel, the people are fearful. But read what happens on the screen. It's Luke 24 from verse 37. They're startled and they're frightened. They think they've seen a ghost. But Jesus says to them, "Why are you troubled and why do doubts rise in your minds? Look at my hands and my feet. It is I myself. Touch me and see. A ghost doesn't have flesh and bones as you see I have." And then he shows them his hands and his feet. And while they still don't believe, because of what? Because of their joy and amazement. He says to them, "Have you got anything to eat?" They give him a piece of broiled fish, takes it and eats it in their presence because, you see, he's very human and very alive and very hungry. This is too good to be true. And yet it is true. Death defeated. Jesus undefeated. And then virtually you see that almost the last words of Luke's gospel say this: then they worshipped him and returned to Jerusalem with great joy. Which starts a trend, I think, that's still around today, that we Christians of all people are meant to be marked by that same joy and that same worship of our Lord Jesus. We are the people with something to celebrate, in that we know that once and for all and for sure that God is looking favourably on us. Not because of us, but because of the gift of Jesus. That we can be certain of God's mercy and God's forgiveness because in the death of Jesus a price has been paid beyond measure that's covered our debt. That we can be 100% sure that God has treated us with generosity and life in the end wins and death doesn't. Our joy comes from that. Not that we're ridiculously chirpy all the time, well, I'm certainly not, but that we've got that deep conviction that brings a deep enjoyment in bad times and in good. So, friends, I don't want you to go from here this morning with just a three-point plan to listen to music from a happy time in your life and smile more and go for a morning walk with a friend, as if those things can change your life for the better in any deep way. I want to offer you a joy that runs deeper than just the happy feeling of good circumstances. Sometimes you'll have that happy feeling. Sometimes I guess you won't. But you see, Christian joy, it's an enjoyment when you're trusting Jesus that runs right down to the depths of the deep appreciation of the good news that God is on our side right to the end, no matter what. Which is why we can finish again this morning with the same words from the disciple Peter that we saw last week, writing to Christians going through hard times of persecution for their faith. And he says to them, "Look to the resurrection and the hope there. We were in mourning when they killed him, but then he came back. And we have been rejoicing and worshipping him ever since." Hear his words, Peter from his first letter. "Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In his great mercy he has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead and into an inheritance that can never perish, spoil or fade. In all this you greatly rejoice, though now for a little while you may have had to suffer grief in all kinds of trials." Astonishing, isn't it? If the resurrection of Jesus is true, then you and I can actually be joyful. We can rejoice at the same time as we're suffering the deepest grief or melancholy. We can actually choose to enjoy God's favour to us as we go through all kinds of trials. 2,000 years of Christians now have actually tried that and found it to be true. Which is why we can sing in a few moments the words of "Joy to the World," as if we really mean it. But before we do that, Gary's going to lead us in prayer.
Let's pray. Heavenly Father, Phil started his talk today by talking to us about ways that people deal with their struggles and their worry and their fear and try to turn it to happiness. Yet he's gone on and shown us from your word how the fear of Mary and the shepherds when the heavenly messages appeared to them turned to joy, and the disciples later on when Jesus appeared to them and they were so afraid, they received and believed the message of your grace and generosity. Without this message of hope, only fear would have remained. And Father, the knowledge of our sin and its penalty revealed in your word could fill us with fear and dread, if not for the message of forgiveness and hope that we find in the gospel. We thank you, Heavenly Father, for your grace and generosity in sending Jesus as our Saviour, and for the relief and the joy that it brings to us. We're grateful, Lord, that not even the fear of death prevailed against the joy of knowing Jesus, because he has conquered even death and promises us that same victory. At this Christmas time, Father, fill us with the hope and the joy that flows from the certainty of forgiveness and of life that never ends. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.